Lars, what do you expect this year? Are you concerned about a patent cliff? Are you concerned about pricing pressures in the U.S.? What's the main risk that you're looking at?
I'm actually quite optimistic about 2018. We have guided the market that we'll see a 2 to 5% growth in top line and a 1 to 5% growth in bottom line. The key thing that came out in our release here is that we see significant headwind for the US dollar that has depreciated significantly versus Danish kroner, taking our top line down by expectedly 7% and profit by 10% if the current exchange rates continue. So that's, you know, the currency is actually the key issue for me right now.
How do you expect that to pan out this year? I mean, do you think that the currency is going to keep is going to continue being a problem in 2018? What do you expect from the dollar?
I wish I knew. I cannot comment on the dollar development, but what is important for us is that we have very strong momentum in our business right now. We see a continued uptake of Toshiba, our long-acting insulin, that doubled in market share in 2017. And we're seeing that Victoza, our GLP-1 product, now having cardiovascular safety and protection on label, is actually surely growing in new scripts in the U.S. And then we are launching our once-weekly GLP-1 Ozempic in the U.S. market come this Monday. So we have a lot going for us in the diabetes space. So that's what we're focusing on. We cannot change the currencies.
All right. So even if you take out the effect of currencies, you've got really a tailwind in the U.S. with the tax reform. Can you quantify the effect of the tax bill on Novo Nordisk's business?
Yeah, we expect that we'll have a lowering of our effective tax rate by, say, 1.5 percentage points, around an effective tax rate of 21% in the U.S. And we are already investing in the U.S. We are building a $2 billion U.S. dollar plant in North Carolina. So we see a strong opportunity in the U.S., and we are investing also now based on a lower tax rate.
So what else do you see coming out of the U.S.? President Trump has made a lot of noise about prescription drug prices. Are you concerned that that could be a headwind for you?
I think the rhetoric from Trump's in his State of the Nation speech is similar to what we heard a year ago. So I don't see a lot of change there. I do think there is a need for some reform of the U.S. Healthcare system. In particular, some of those patients that are faced with high deductible plans ending up paying list prices, we need to find ways to solve that. We have already taken some initiatives, but we're looking to take more to take care of those patients getting access to the rebates that we are already paying.
Well, why are list prices so high, Lars? I mean, what is the mechanics of the pricing of your products? Is FDA approval so expensive that you just need to have such high prices?
If you look in the diabetes space, and the cost of treating diabetes, these are highly sophisticated products, and as I mentioned, we're investing $2 billion in a plant in North Carolina. So there is significant cost behind developing these products. But it should also be said that we pay significant rebates. You can see in our accounts that we paid on average 64% in rebate. So what we pocket is the net price after having paid the 64% rebates. And in the insulin space, net pricing is actually going down, and that's based on competition. So I think the market forces are working in the U.S., and that is taking insulin pricing down.
Let's talk about M&A for a moment. You were outbid by Sanofi for Ablynx this week. What happened there? Why didn't you win that fight?
Well, when you have to look at acquiring a company, you, of course, have to calculate what is the value to you. And different companies can have different value. It turned out that for Sanofi, they could calculate a higher value, so they must have a stronger fit. We looked at it from our side, and we are committed to do in-licensing and M&A in the biopharm space, but we are also committed to stay disciplined when it comes to value to make sure that our shareholders have a fair return on what we go out and do. So in this case, Sanofi had a higher bid. And I acknowledge that, and we will be pleased to continue our partnership with Sanofi based on the collaboration we have with Ablynx already.
What's your next step, though, as far as M&A? I mean, do you need to find another target?
We have a list of opportunities where we can either do in-licensing or potentially acquisitions, like most companies have. So we'll continue working on that. And we hope that during the first 6 months of 2018, we can land one of these deals. But obviously, it's a competitive space out there. There's very high premiums being paid. So we have to stay disciplined in how we look at value. But we're committed to work with this.